So, moving on to chapter 20, psychotropic medications, alcohol, and drug abuse. This is a long chapter. It covers a lot of information. So, just keep that in mind as we're going through this. psychotropics refer to any substance that acts on the mind, and they are used for therapeutic effects for a person's emotions, behavior, possibly if they have sleeping issues. There's a lot of different uses for psychotropics. They are divided into five classes: central nervous system stimulants, antidepressants, anxiolytics, anxiety basically, anxiolytic, antimanics, and antipsychotic medications. let's start off with CNS stimulants. Caffeine is pretty familiar to almost everyone. A lot of us use it daily in the form of coffee or tea in order to help fight fatigue and stay awake, sort of get our day going. Usually at doses of 100 to 200 milligrams, not more often than every 3 to 4 hours. Those are doses that you can take in tablet form, and that is sold over the counter in most drugstores. However, you commonly know caffeine to be in coffee. Prolonged high intake of caffeine can produce tolerance, meaning you need more and more in order to reach the same level of awakeness. In addition, once you stop taking it, it's almost habit forming. Once you stop using caffeine or taking caffeine every day, you can have a pretty bad withdrawal effect, whether it's fatigue, headache, etc. Other withdrawal signs: irritation, nervousness, anxiety, dizziness. So people who have been drinking coffee or taking caffeine pills for an extended period of time will experience those symptoms if they suddenly stop taking it. Excessive consumption of caffeine can lead to life-threatening irregular heartbeats, heart attacks, and seizures. And I think they are seeing a rise in college students who have consumed excessive amount of caffeine or highly caffeinated energy drinks, making visits to the ER. Amphetamine methylphenidate preparations, CNS stimulants. These are used specifically for ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And they're used to help the children focus when they're diagnosed with ADHD. children over six, some common names you might be familiar with: Ritalin, Concerta, Vyvanse. Daytrona is a patch that they make that is a stimulant. These are controlled substances. They're Schedule II, which is the highest you go before street illegal drugs, basically. So the book talks a little bit about Daytrona, Vyvanse. Usually, they're only used for ADHD. Some doctors will prescribe them for weight loss, but again, tolerance develops rapidly, and they're also a controlled substance, so people can develop a dependence. Side effects of controlled CNS stimulants can include nervousness, tachycardia, palpitations, dizziness, GI disturbances, and as well as addiction, habituation, and dependence with prolonged use. So there have been serious cardiovascular adverse events reported. Patients who have a history of any sort of heart problem or defects should not be using these medication. Another thing that you might see is children who are on stimulants for ADHD tend to have slower growth than those who are not on those medications. They do usually catch up once those medications are stopped. However, they will be behind for the time that they're on them. Precautions, treatment for obesity, again, never more than 3 to 6 weeks. Anxiety, if a patient has a history of anxiety or agitation, or a history of alcoholism or drug dependence. Cardiovascular disorders, we already covered. Abrupt withdrawal, because it can result in depression, so we want to taper these medications down. And use with a group of medications called monoamine oxidase inhibitors can cause hypertensive crisis, so we want to avoid that. Talked a little bit about pediatric precautions with the growth stunting. These medications can also exacerbate if the child has a tic or Tourette's syndrome, so we proceed with caution in those patients as well. Wakefulness promoting agents, modafinil, Provigil, as well as Nuvigil, are the most common ones in this class, and they're used for people who have narcolepsy, which is where you fall asleep without warning in the middle of the day. They can also be used for shift workers, people who work overnight and have trouble staying up at that hour because it's not normal for us to be awake overnight. Side effects include, they're mild, headache, dizziness, nausea, anorexia, mood changes, hypertension, palpitations. Possible causes of fatigue and sleepiness should be determined before stimulant medications are prescribed. So if there are other issues going on, we want to investigate and treat those first before we prescribe a stimulant. Moving on to selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors for ADHD. There's only one in this class. It's called atomoxetine. It is the first non-stimulant, non-controlled drug approved to treat ADHD. It's also pretty effective in adults with ADHD, so it's often used there. Side effects include dry mouth, reduced appetite and fatigue, nausea, vomiting, increased risk of suicidal tendencies in children. So we do keep an eye on that as well. We ask parents to report any sort of changes in their child's mood or behavior. Precautions include narrow angle glaucoma, cerebrovascular, heart, or hepatic disease, as well as possible growth disturbance during treatment. Same idea as the stimulants, but probably not as bad as, say, Ritalin or any of those other CNS stimulants. Moving on to antidepressants. Major depressive disorder is a mental disorder characterized by an all-encompassing low mood accompanied by low self-esteem and loss of interest or pleasure in normally enjoyable activities. It affects about 15 million people annually in America, and about 16% of Americans will experience major depressive disorder at least once in their lifetime. Usually it's due to chemical imbalances, specifically dopamine, serotonin, and norepinephrine. These are neurotransmitters that are in our brain, and when they are at lower levels, you can experience that depression. So a lot of the drugs are focused on preventing the reuptake of these neurotransmitters. We want to keep them around, just have them stick around as long as possible. So in depression, there may be a shortage of the neurotransmitters, dopamine, serotonin, and norepinephrine. So you'll hear names like serotonin reuptake inhibitor, norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, and that means that it's allowing the neurotransmitter to stick around for longer. Antidepressants are further divided into five categories: monoamine oxidase inhibitors, MAOIs, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, SSRIs, and selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, SNRIs, as well as heterocyclic antidepressants. When we treat depression, we usually start low and go slow with the dose. It's titrated up slowly. In addition, it can take 6 to 12 weeks for it to be fully effective. So if someone comes back in 2 to 4 and they're telling you it's not working, it needs to be given a little more time. We don't stop these medications due to rebound depression. We titrate them very gently. And again, it comes with the same warning as the atomoxetine that we talked about earlier, where the black box warning on it is that there's increased risk of suicidal thinking and behavior, especially in the first few months of therapy, and especially in children. We try to keep an eye on them. They don't logic through their emotions as well, so they're more at risk for this increased risk of suicide. The reason this happens is because when somebody's depressed, they may not be able to form a plan in their head and carry it out for suicide. So once you've given them antidepressants, all of a sudden their mood's a little lifted, and if that suicidal ideation is there, they now have the energy and the wherewithal to carry that plan out. So always like them to report to their doctor or to their pharmacist if they do have an increased feeling like they are having suicidal ideations. Tricyclics. So they involve potentiation of norepinephrine and serotonin activity by blocking their uptake. They are also strong anticholinergics, so they have a lot of anticholinergic side effects. They can be lethal in overdose. There is a ceiling dose, and once you pass it, it can be cardiotoxic, causing arrhythmias and conduction abnormalities. Mood. After 2 to 4 weeks, they start to be as effective as they're going to be. Usually given at bedtime because they do make you drowsy. That's part of the anticholinergic side effect profile. They may be more effective than SSRIs, but again, they are dangerous because of that possible toxicity. Tricyclics include nortriptyline, imipramine, amitriptyline. They all kind of sound the same on that end there. Side effects usually include dryness of the mouth, increased appetite and weight gain, drowsiness and dizziness, constipation, sexual dysfunction, postural hypotension, cardiac arrhythmias, and confusion, especially in older adults. And a lot of those are specifically because they have anticholinergic effects. Monoamine oxidase inhibitors, they increase concentrations of serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine by inhibiting the enzyme that degrades these neurotransmitters. They have a lot of drug interactions. They're not very commonly used. They're sort of used as if a patient's refractory to other treatment or if a patient isn't successful with other treatments. Phenylzine is one of them. Let's see, I think I give you a table somewhere in here. Phenylzine, isocarboxazide, and tranexamic. Hard to say. You don't see them used too often. Again, if somebody's on them, there's a lot of drug and food interactions, so they have to sort of be careful with that. So that's why they're not used as often as the SSRIs or even the tricyclic antidepressants. Side effects include nervousness, agitation, headache, stiff neck, hypertensive crisis, another problem with these medications because it can be fatal, tachycardia, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and blurred vision. So we usually don't use them, especially not in pregnant women, children under 16, patients with a history of heart or cerebrovascular or liver or renal disease. There's a long list of why you wouldn't use them. Let's see. Selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. These are so common. A lot of patients are on them. They're usually pretty mild as far as side effects and problems. And once the patient is used to taking them, there's not a whole lot of problems that come along with them. Fewer side effects, greater safety in cases of overdose, increased patient compliance. So it blocks the reabsorption of the neurotransmitter serotonin, thus restoring the brain's chemical balance. Drugs in this class, you might be familiar with Prozac or Zoloft. Another one is Lexapro. And therapy may be required for several months or longer. And it can take up to 4 weeks for a patient to start to feel better. Let's see. Fluoxetine and escitalopram are the only antidepressants recommended for the treatment of major depressive disorder in adolescents. Fluoxetine is also approved for children 8 years and older. Side effects, sexual dysfunction, nausea and GI effects, insomnia, sweating, etc. QT prolongation with citalopram doses greater than 40 milligrams a day. And again, we want to be careful not just to discontinue these medications. They come with the same suicidal ideation warnings. I believe there is a black box warning on that. And in addition, if you discontinue them, there are some withdrawal effects. So we taper these medications once the patient is once it's time for them to come off of them. selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors. Duloxetine and venlafaxine are the drugs in this class. I believe there's another version of venlafaxine that is also available now. They inhibit the reuptake of both serotonin and norepinephrine. They're also effective in patients with nerve pain, as well as musculoskeletal pain. You'll see the same side effects with those as you do with the SSRIs. And last but not least, the heterocyclic antidepressants. They are comparable to in efficacy to the first generation tricyclics, but have differing effects on dopamine, norepinephrine, and serotonin. Specifically, drugs in this class, bupropion, which is considered an activating antidepressant. And this is especially good for patients who have depression that's causing extreme fatigue, lethargy, etc. Bupropion does have an increased risk of seizures, and that risk goes up as the dose goes up. So we want to be careful in patients who have a history of seizure disorder. Mirtazapine is a calming antidepressant that can be useful in treating agitated depression, mixed anxiety, or even fibromyalgia. Mirtazapine has a side effect of weight gain, so it can be good for someone whose depression may involve an anorexic component. Trazodone is highly sedating and used in low doses as a hypnotic. It's usually given at bedtime, and let's see, agitation. It's useful for treating agitation secondary to dementia. So side effects of these medications can include drowsiness, insomnia, dry mouth, weight gain, etc. Moving on to anti-manic agents. Bipolar disorder, sometimes called manic depression, is characterized by severe fluctuations in mood. Sometimes a patient is up and they're happy and they're almost what they so what they call manic, somebody who's doing things that might be inappropriate otherwise, spending a ton of money, gambling, drinking excessively, making poor decisions, but then they fluctuate down to that low mood, depression essentially. The cause of bipolar disorder is most likely an imbalance in brain chemicals. Without treatment, it is a debilitating condition that will not improve on its own. Lithium is the most common drug used to treat bipolar disorder. It prevents more of the manic episodes as compared to the depressive episodes, but it's a mood stabilizer. Serum levels, it's important to check lithium because it can be toxic. Serum levels are checked 7 days after starting, and then every 6 to 12 months once a stable dose is reached. We're aiming for levels between 0.8 and 1.2 MEQs per mil. And patients should be monitored for signs of toxicity, which include drowsiness, confusion, blurred vision, and sensitivity to light, as well as tremors, muscle weakness, seizures, coma, and cardiovascular collapse. Pretty serious stuff. So we want to be careful in a patient who has a seizure disorder or Parkinson's disease, if they have cardiovascular or kidney disorders. We want to be careful in patients with thyroid disease as well as older adults. So side effects, GI distress, cardiac arrhythmias and hypotension, weight gain, tremors, but really we want to keep an eye out for those toxicities that we talked about before. Anxiolytics. Benzodiazepines. I'm sure you've heard of somebody saying, I just need a Xanax. That is a benzodiazepine. They are controlled substances, and they are good for treating anxiety. They also can be used to treat insomnia or alcohol withdrawal, but most often you see them used as needed, PRN, for anxiety. Valium can also be used as a muscle relaxant. Forgot about that one. And they are used in seizures as well. If somebody's having a seizure and you need to stop it, usually those are the first types of drugs they'll go for. Not long-term use, say like daily to prevent them, but definitely to stop them. Doses, let's see. These medications can cause you to develop habituation and dependence, so we try not to use them for prolonged periods of time. They are abused quite frequently, especially by adolescents and teenagers. Sudden withdrawal may result in seizures, agitation, psychosis, insomnia, and gastric distress. So again, we never just discontinue this. We taper it slowly, if at all possible. Side effects, depression, hallucinations, confusion, agitation, drowsiness, ataxia, and tremor, increased risk of falls, especially with older patients, and sensitivity to sunlight. So, interactions, midazolam, some of the drugs in this class, alprazolam, clonazepam, clorazepate, oxazepam, lorazepam, you see they all kind of sound, we call them the PAM sometimes. Midazolam is a potent benzodiazepine used in the hospital. It's usually used preoperatively to reduce anxiety, as well as provide a light sedation. It is a wonderful drug if you are going in for surgery and you are nervous, and it's administered intravenously. And side effects can include depressed respirations. It can actually, that can occur with any of the benzodiazepines, so always keeping an eye on your patient's respiratory status. How are they breathing often enough? Are they breathing at all? So if you give the patient the dose of a benzodiazepine and you walk out of the room, you want to walk back in a few minutes later and check on them, and a few minutes after that. So it's never something that you give and just forget. Other anxiolytics not related to the benzodiazepines include buspirone and hydroxyzine. Buspirone has no anticonvulsant or muscle relaxant activity. It does not substantially impair psychomotor function and has little sedative effect, which can be good. It's usually used for generalized anxiety disorder, but is not effective for depression. Buspirone has a slower onset of action than most anxiolytics, 2 to 4 weeks for optimum effect. Therefore, it's not used as needed. It's really used on a daily basis. It has little potential for tolerance or dependence, which is good. Its side effects include dizziness, drowsiness, headache, GI effects, etc. Antipsychotic medications, major tranquilizers. Antipsychotic medications are sometimes called neuroleptics, and consist of the typical first generation or atypical second generation agents. They relieve symptoms of psychosis, including delusion, hallucinations, agitation, and combativeness, and they're also good for nausea and vomiting in some cases. Let's see where this chapter goes, though. So first generations come along with a lot of side effects, which is why they develop the second generation agents to cut down on some of those side effects. Those side effects that we're talking about that are important are extrapyramidal side effects, EPS, which can include movement disorders such as tardive dyskinesia. It can also include muscle rigidity, tremors, difficulty walking, involuntary repetitive movements, that is tardive dyskinesia. And that is why we have the atypical antipsychotics, the second generation antipsychotics, in order to cut down on some of those side effects that we were seeing when we were treating people with the first generations. Some medications that are typical antipsychotics first generation, chlorpromazine, haloperidol, again, not as commonly used anymore. Second generation or atypicals, risperidone, quetiapine, olanzapine, they work by blocking both serotonin and transiently blocking dopamine receptors as well. And this leads to less effect on the extrapyramidal side effects. Let's see, what else can I tell you about them? They're used commonly in the hospital as a PRN sort of, especially for agitated patients, possibly patients with dementia. It's not always pretty because it is kind of knocking the patient down as far as like their mental status, and we don't want to do that, but sometimes it is necessary to keep the patient from being a harm to themselves or others. Side effects of all antipsychotics may include postural hypotension, tachycardia, bradycardia, and vertigo, anticholinergic side effects, the extrapyramidal symptoms that we talked about, as well as metabolic effects such as increased risk of hyperglycemia, insulin resistance, weight gain, not fun stuff. So we always try to be careful using it in patients who have diabetes, as it can agitate or make it worse. Let's see. Skipping a few pages here, they've got charts for abnormal involuntary movement scale to see if the patient is at risk for tardive dyskinesia or if they have already developed it. And that is important to keep an eye on. So moving on to drug abuse, this is a fun topic. And by fun, I mean it's kind of sad, because drug abuse and alcohol abuse has been a thing for a very long time, and it seems like it's only getting worse. So an estimated 22.5 million individuals in the United States are diagnosed with substance abuse or dependence. Of this number, 15.4 million were dependent on alcohol alone. 3.9 were dependent on or abused illicit drugs alone, and 3.2 million were both drugs and illicit drugs and alcohol. Addiction is a combination of all four of the following phenomenons: tolerance, psychological dependence, physical dependence, and withdrawal syndrome. Psychological dependence meaning in their mind they feel like they need it to function or they can't live without it. Physical dependence means your body, should you take away this drug or alcohol, will go through withdrawal. Habituation consists of psychological dependence only. So there is a difference between addiction and habituation. Alcohol, CNS depressant. You guys should be pretty familiar with this. Alcohol slows you down. It makes you react slower. It can cause coma, stupor, depressed respirations. When mixed with other drugs such as benzodiazepines, it can cause death. It decreases control over judgment, memory, and other intellectual and emotional functioning. Prolonged use can permanently damage the central nervous system and results in other syndromes as well. It affects all of the major organs in the body, especially the liver. It can cause pancreatitis, which can be fatal for an alcoholic. It can cause damage to the lining of the stomach. It's an irritant. So although you guys should be pretty familiar with this, you will see, I know at least in our hospital, we have a SPARC, which is Addiction Recovery Program, And when these patients come in, they're coming in usually out of their own free will to check in, but they are treated with benzodiazepines to help with alcohol withdrawal. It can be a nasty, nasty experience for them. Withdrawal is not pretty. You'd be amazed too that alcoholism could be defined as one or two drinks per day, 5 or 6 days a week. If you think about it, you have a glass of wine with dinner, maybe two, and you do that every night. Technically, by definition, alcoholism. However, I think what it really starts to be defined as alcoholism is when it starts controlling other parts of your life. Alcohol poisoning. Symptoms include cold, clammy skin, noisy respirations, alcoholic breath. Treatment for this includes close observation for any respiratory problems, vomiting, seizures, cerebral edema, electrolyte imbalance, as well as withdrawal syndromes. Symptoms can be treated, but it does have to just occur and work its way out of the system. Chronic alcoholism, symptoms include frequent falls and accidents, blackouts and memory loss, dulling of mental faculties, irritability, tremors, conjunctivitis, gastroenteritis, neglect of personal appearance and responsibilities. And treatment is usually in-house rehabilitation, as well as some vitamins, rebalancing electrolytes, IV fluids. And once you are an addict or an alcoholic, you're recovering. You're never not an addict or alcoholic. There are medications that can be used to help a patient stop drinking. Disulfiram, Antabuse, is a medication that if the patient drinks while on it, they will become violently ill. Because it prevents the alcohol from being metabolized. Another is naltrexone. It's a long-acting opiate antagonist, which acts by blocking the pleasurable sensation associated with drinking. So there are options out there. Prescription drug abuse and illegal drug abuse. I'm gonna let you guys read through this because at this point we're almost up to 30 minutes for this video, and it'll take a really long time to upload. Prescription drug abuse and illegal drug abuse are on the rise. Sometimes they go hand in hand. You'll see somebody addicted to OxyContin when it becomes hard to get or too expensive because of market fluctuations, then they turn to heroin. So read through this, recognize the difference between addiction and tolerance or habituation. And if you have any questions, please feel free to email me. Hope that covered all of your information for psychotropics. And we'll be moving on to chapter 21 next.